her there. So y'all just receive her right now. Come on, Papa Michelle, just go as God gives you.
Hello. How's everyone?
Great.
Hello?
Great.
I know you all been traveling and everything, but it's great to be here. Amen? Hallelujah. Before we get started, I did bring some product with me tonight. I really believe we're in a season that we really need to know how to hear His voice. Amen. Really, not only hear, but I've seen a lot of people, you know, we've been talking about the prophetic, and actually I've been in prophetic ministry now for about 20 years. And what I've seen is this: a lot of people can hear the voice of God. We get the revelation, but we mess up. I said mess up. In the area of interpretation and application. So you never get the right manifestation. How many of you know you can hear God, but if you interpret it the wrong way, you've messed up right there. So I have a passion to demystify the prophetic realm. It is one of, I've spent my life, actually I've been to about 52 nations, just preaching and teaching on the prophetic ministry. So I can't say I have a little experience in it, but I really want to see a generation raised up to really know the voice of God. Not just know, but know His heart, know His expression. Amen? How many of us, so many people think God is mad at them. But He's not. But Jesus came to show us a better way. Right? When Jesus came, He began to just show us what the Father was like. Amen? It's about relationship. So what I did was I wrote this book. It's called The Prophetic Advantage. Be God's mouthpiece and transform your world. I believe God wants the prophetic to be an advantage. It should not be something that we're afraid of. Actually, it's our birthright to hear the voice of God and to speak the voice of God. I mean, there's a supernatural manifestation, and you'll see some of it tonight. When we release the voice of God, it begins to align us with destiny and purpose. And this is one of the things I teach, and we're going to do a lot of teaching tomorrow on the prophetic. If it doesn't sound like a father talking to a son or a daughter, I say put it in the garbage. The other day I said garbage. No. But I have that book out there for you. And then I wrote this book, and I think I've started writing a series of books for women. I really believe that God is awakening a company of women to move forth in power. Amen? To really move us forth in our destiny. And just a little bit about me. My mom died when I was 3, and I was not raised in the church. So when I got in the church, I didn't have a lot of Christian role models. Meaning Christian women role models. So the Lord began to talk to me about my life through the life of women in the Bible. So the first woman I wrote about is Esther. And I really believe we're moving in a time where we got to make a resolve in our heart. You know, if I perish, I perish, but I'm going to do what God has assigned me to do. Amen. Amen. So I wrote this book to give you some insight on the Esther anointing. And then my other baby that I wrote is called the Deborah anointing. This is the fullness of my life. I really believe God is awakening women to help us. The word that we're saying, hearing loud in the body of Christ, is collaboration. Amen. I really believe that God is going to show us how to walk with men. One of the things in my life, I've always been around what you would call general, male generals. And they would say to me, you need to reproduce yourself. I'm like, why am I the only one? That's always the only woman. If I name some of the men, you all would know them. They're very strong, apostolic, governmental men. And the Lord began to show me, ladies, how to walk with men in authority. Amen. How to be a woman of authority, but to submit to authority. So that's what this book is about. And this is hot off the press. You can't even get it. Some people have gotten it online, but it's not due to be released to April 4th, so you get it first. This is called The Anna Anointing, How to Become a Woman of Boldness, Power, and Strength. Everything I do came out of a life of prayer. Amen. Anna was a woman who got married early. Right? She got married really about 14. She lived with her husband for 7 years and he suddenly died. So this book is about how to recover after loss. And she found her purpose in the face of God. So I really talk a lot about prayer, intercession, devotion to God. Also, God is anointing us not just to stay in the spirit. How many people know we've had moves where you have people who just love to be in the presence of the Lord? I'm soaking in His presence. Right? But God is saying, after the soaking, after the encounter, you got to get up and do something. Amen. One of the things they don't say about, you don't hear a lot about Anna is, it says that she spent time fasting and praying day and night, and she would tell of the Savior to those who look for redemption. So that means she was not just fasting and praying, she was out preaching and moving in miracles. That's what God told me. So I have that book out there for you. Amen. All right, come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap. Amen, amen, amen. I'm excited for tonight. Let's just lift up our hands and our hearts to the Lord. Father, we pray for your kingdom come and for your will to be done tonight. Lord, I pray that an outpouring of the Spirit will come. Lord, that you would pour out your Spirit in this place tonight. Father, I pray for an open heaven. Let there be open heavens, open windows, and open doors. Whatever's been shut in our lives, I decree, God, that you are opening it. I take authority over every demonic assignment against your life, against your destiny. For tonight is a night of destiny. You're going to be activated and shifted into your destiny. Whatever barrier that's been stopping you from moving forward in your destiny, I decree that it's broken tonight. Father, I pray tonight it will not just be a regular service, but it'll be a night where you begin to catapult your people into destiny. For you said, I know who you are and I have a plan for you. So I just decree tonight that you would awaken us and those who are tired. Let there be supernatural strength. Those who drove far, Father, I pray that you would strengthen them with might in their inner man. I decree an awakening in this place, God, that you would wake us up, God, that we would put a demand on heaven, Lord. Whatever's been stopping your people, let tonight be a night of movement. Let tonight be a night of activation. Let tonight be a night of demonstration. God, I pray that you would make every crooked place straight and every rough place smooth. Whatever's been stopping your people, God, I pray that you would unlock heaven. Let tonight be a night that you unlock destiny. Let destiny be unlocked in this place. I decree, Lord, you reveal yourself as the breaker. Whatever's been stopping and blocking, I decree that you would break us through tonight, oh God.
Yes, God.
Yes, God. You might as well wake up. You didn't drove and you got here. Father, I pray for the fire. Let the fire of God fall in this place. The fire of God. The fire of God. Let there be a stirring in the atmosphere. We put a demand on the anointing. God, I pray for a supernatural empowerment. Speak to the DNA of your people, oh God. Speak to their DNA. Strengthen them with might. Somebody say might. Father, let the spirit of might be released in this place tonight. For with your mighty hand and your outstretched arm, God, you are moving us forward. I decree that every Red Sea, everything that's been chasing you, everything that's impossible, that's been impossible, God, I decree that you depart, that you part the Red Sea, part the Red Sea. Let the horse and the rider be drowned in the Red Sea tonight, oh God. Come on, come on, just for a few moments. Come on, shake yourselves. Come on, stir yourselves up. I'm not going to work in here by myself tonight. Clap, clap, clap your hands in this place. Oh, I know you've been working all day. You pressed your way, so you might as well put a demand on the anointing. Oh, God, we glorify you. We magnify you tonight, Jesus. God is coming for the head. Whatever's been chasing. was dragging. I'm telling you, I really believe that God is doing something in the realm of destiny this weekend. I've been really meditating on destiny, and God is, I really feel like one of the dimensions of the prophetic anointing is God wants to answer the why of your life. Have you ever looked around and said, why is all of this happening to me? I believe this is such a season of alignment. God is aligning us. And when God begins to align you for your assignment, oh my God, it's always bigger. It's always greater. You know, so and another thing I heard him say as I walked in the building, he says, I'm restoring dreams tonight. He's restoring dreams. And I have a word on destiny tonight. I want to talk on destiny. But I just heard God say this. You know, I'm a prophet. I'm one of those apostolic prophets. I just go with God.
There you go.
Amen. Come on, but tonight we're going to talk about destiny, and I want to talk about removing barriers to destiny. Amen. I believe there's so many of us, you know, we don't understand what the fight is all about. And I really, I'm a proponent of the prophetic. I mean, I found my, who I was. As I told you, when I was three, I was orphaned. My mom died and my father didn't want me. And you search through life, you know, I did everything, every self-help group, whatever they said was the standard to be a better person, I did it. And none of it worked. It wasn't until I came in contact with the prophets. And they began to prophesy. And the first thing they said to me, you're not in this world by chance. You're not in this decade by chance. That may seem like, oh, that don't seem deep, but if you live the life searching for why you're here, what for, you know, the why of your life, why am I here, why did my mother die, you know, by the time I got that word, I had been married, divorced, daughter born with a visual impairment, and I was like a good Baptist girl. You know, I was a good Baptist girl, BTU, you know, so nothing was making sense until I came in contact with the prophets. So that's my passion. I have a passion to unlock destiny. I'm gonna prophesy. You don't have to put up your force fields with me. I'm not gonna prophesy about your social security number because you should know that already. I'm not gonna prophesy your bank account number and how much you got. That's not me. I am an apostle that's a prophet that I want to break you through and send you into your destiny. We don't have time to play games. God is speaking. He's released. Not only is he speaking, he said, Michelle, I am awakening destiny. Some things he's hidden from you so you wouldn't destroy. Until you develop into who he's called you to be, certain things his mercy wouldn't let you touch it. We're like, God, when is going to be my time? You know, we're waiting on God, and really God is waiting on us. The thing I've learned about the Heavenly Father is this. He is committed to your growth. He's committed to you growing up, and there are certain things he will not give you until you have the capacity to hold it. I was up preaching last week, and the Lord told me, it just came out prophetically, real judgment is to have success in the wrong area. You could be gifted and called by God and have all the gifts and the money and everything is working. I'm going to tell you how his judgment. Look at this. Didn't he say, what did he say in Matthew? Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. But God, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out devils in your name? So apparently the prophecies had to be accurate. Apparently the devils had to be coming out. Because see, they thought they was in the right place. But I'm telling you, this is a season, beloved. If you, God is going to unlock your destiny, it's going to be bigger than you thought. It's not going to be with the people you thought it was going to be with. Come on. This is a season. As the man of God, he said, get to say, are you going to say yes when it don't look like it? Are you going to say yes when people who you thought was going to pour into your life and be all that to you, when they're saying no and God's telling you to go the other way? Come on, this is an hour when I Apostle Stephen Gardner's church that's 30 minutes away. I gotta take an 18-hour flight. Come on here.
Yeah.
People saying, why can't you just go to Gary? Why you got to go all the way to Lebanon? Something in me. I pray tonight that God will begin to turn that compass inside of you called destiny. Now, when we talk about destiny, let me get into the word. I'm going to get back to that. Let's go over to Jeremiah 29. And I know a lot of people teach this, but I pray that it'll awaken something. There are times when we can speak scriptures and speak scriptures, and we have what I call dullness of hearing because you never see the scripture fulfilled in your life. They were like, yeah, I know that word. But I promise you tonight, if you would just listen with me, you know, some things are taught, other things are caught. All right? So I want you to catch some things tonight. That's the power of prophecy. I'm a teacher, preacher, so I'm a treach. But we're going to roll with the Spirit tonight, amen?
Amen.
All right. Jeremiah 29:11. It says this, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all of your heart. Amen? Now, this is what I want to talk about. God says, this is where we're going to start. He says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you. He says, I know. And it's our job to put a demand on the Lord to get his thoughts.
Amen.
Many of us are so filled with the thoughts of men, with the thoughts of other people, with what everybody else has said. But I'm telling you, one of the dimensions of the prophetic anointing is to unlock the thoughts of God about human beings. God kept telling me, he said, Michelle, tell my people the thing that stops them are the things from within. The things you think about yourself stops you more than the things that other people are thinking about you. He said, everything, or the only thing that can stop you are things within, insecurities. He said, tonight he's coming after every insecurity. We have got to find our confidence in the Lord. We cannot have confidence in man. This is such a season. We cannot be insecure about who God is. I'm telling you, this is an hour that God is redefining. He's given us new definitions about who he is. We have had so many misconceptions about the characters of God, but he said this is an hour and we're going to walk in our destiny, our God-given purpose. We got to deal with the end things, insecurities, intimidation, inabilities. Come on. God said tonight we are not going to look to ourselves. Say this with me. Shy is a lie. What does that mean? Some of them, I can't do that. I'm shy. I'm an introvert. But if God has designed you, really you got fear of man. Really you're concerned whether someone is going to accept what God has called you to be or not to be. That is the question. I have come to understand, God told Jeremiah, not Jeremiah, but Isaiah. He said, listen, I'm going to send you to a people that don't believe me. They stiff-necked. They're rebellious. They don't have any sight. They can't hear. And Jeremiah said, send me, I'll go. Why? Because he did not allow his circumstances or how the people respond determine how far he was willing to go for God. And I'm telling you tonight, God is giving you permission to be a real Christian. Tonight, God is giving you permission. He's going to unlock destiny. He's going to speak to you so loud about what you've been designed to do. And you cannot go to look to other people for permission to be what God's told you to be. We are such a generation where we're insecure. We have so much intimidation. from a lion. When I began to study the judges and look at the life of Samson, it said the lion began to roar and Samson turned and faced it and tore it from limb to limb. I'm telling you, there's a spirit of might that's being released upon the people of God, because we're going to be so filled with the thoughts of God and what God has said about you. This is a season you're going to break the spirit of dullness of hearing and get delivered from the appearance, from the opinions of men, and move into what God has said about us. There are so many roaring lions walking throughout the land. It says the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. It didn't say he was one. He tries to proclaim, I'm decreeing tonight, whatever the devil has been roaring at you about what you can't do, who you're not, what you don't have, when you begin to step into destiny, God said the provision is in the purpose. Because that's why he tries to keep you out of your purpose, because you'll never get to the provision. But if you begin to understand your destiny and your purpose, you'll begin to see the provision. Could it be you don't have the money that you need because you don't understand your purpose? God said tonight he's unlocking purpose, he's unlocking destiny, and we got to begin to move with what's on the inside of us. In him we live and move and have our being. We got to get so locked into what he's saying. He said, I know my thoughts I think towards you. He said, I know them, but do you know them? They are thoughts of peace. Beloved, the greatest commodity we could have in this hour is peace. Peace that passes all understanding. This is such an hour to tap into the peace of God. Have peace. See, this is what I know about God. God doesn't speak to our future. He speaks from our future. He don't just stand and say, well, come on here, I don't know what's going to happen. No. God is speaking from your future. He's already finished it. That's why he said, I know, look, see, I know the thoughts I think towards you. They are good and not evil. I know the thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. There's another one, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you an expected end, an expected. How can somebody have an expectation of me if they've not already given me some instructions? God has already downloaded you with instructions. He's already downloaded you with things. Your days are numbered. Come on. God told, what did he say over in Psalms 139? He said, I formed your days before they were any. He said, I fashion your days before they even exist. So the goal is this. This is the purpose of the prophetic. It's to unlock those days that God numbered for you. And he says this, before you were in your womb, I knew you. He knew us. That word know there means he had intimate exchange with us. He talked to us before he put us in this body. He designed us and called it finished before we were even here. So the purpose of the prophetic is to tap into those thoughts. The purpose of the prophetic is to tap into what God has already designed you to be. See, that's what the devil's plan is. That's why he tries to curse you when you're in your mother's womb. That's why he puts you with crazy parents sometimes. If you ever look at people who are giants today, they had a terrible childhood because the devil was trying to stop them from identifying and unlocking what was inside of them. Any person you talk to that's really doing anything significant from God, for God, they were like Moses. Can you imagine being put, Moses was put in the Nile River with a bunch of crocodiles trying to eat him up, but God didn't allow it? Come on. God says this, I want you to understand, I got thoughts of peace and not evil. So if you got evil thoughts, you know where they came from. You say, prophetess, why are you spending so much time on your thoughts? Because as a man thinketh, so is he. If we don't have the right thoughts about God, if we don't have the right thoughts about ourselves, we'll never fulfill destiny. God is about aligning people for their destiny. So we don't spend our life spinning our wheels, doing things we were never designed to do. How many people have millions of dollars, but they're suicidal? How many people have great inventions and do all of these phenomenal things, but they're broken on the inside? Come on, this is the time that God wants to fulfill us. He wants us to understand you are not in this world by chance. You're not in the decade by chance. And the thing he said he was doing was restoring the dreams. Some of you have let your dreams die. We are not. God is releasing the spirit of a pioneer. We got to keep pioneering and trailblazing and breaking open territory. We were not called to be settlers. I'm not settling for nothing less than what God has promised me. Just because you're older, come on, age ain't nothing but a number. As long as you got breath in your body, baby, you better get up and do what God has designed you to do. I know my thoughts are think towards you. Thoughts of, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil. Yeah. Not of evil. Whatever the evil thoughts are, I break them tonight. I decree that God will shift your mentality. Every evil thought, we got to learn how to see. Help me, Jesus. This whole, I believe in technology. I believe in moving forward. I believe in social media. But some of it is taking us over. If you get up, the first thing you do, instead of doing anything, not even brush your teeth or go to the bathroom and grab your phone and look at Facebook, you're addicted. We're looking in the face of something. This is like a face, a screen. And we're looking in that face instead of looking into his face. You're just digesting whatever. And then, oh, have you seen people with Facebook rejection? I've been saying some leaders just don't even need to get on the Facebook. Well, if people don't like your page or don't like, I'm like, oh, Lord, girl, you're bleeding over the page again. Just delete it. You're just going to suppress something. You can tell when somebody angry or bitter. Don't nobody pray for you. You pray for everybody else. But God is saying this is the hour. He's raising up people to pray. I'm like, Lord have mercy. That came from your soulless reign. Be like, and you a leader. Get that off the page. Jesus. But this, I'm telling you. So we let all that stuff in. And it deals with our thoughts. It takes up our time. God kept telling, he said, tell my people, I have ordered your steps. He said, the steps of a good man have been ordered. God is ordering our steps, beloved. And we got to begin to align with his steps. There are no shortcuts to success. We see God likes ordered steps. He wants you to meet somebody here, learn something there. But we want to take the elevator. Come on. But the steps of God, they want to take you to a higher place. We cannot. Now, see, because that's what happens when what a prophet said. I'm going to be a doctor. I've been wanting to be a doctor. I come back 3 years later. I'm like, well, did you go to school? Well, prophetess, you said I was going to be a nurse. I said, but baby girl, did you go to nursing school? Did you go get some type of certification? Come on here. Some of us, we want a shortcut. We don't want to do anything. We don't want to work for nothing. We don't want any steps. We want to just take the elevator. Come on here. I had to walk up some steps yesterday. I was like, I think I can. Like the little engine that could. Oh, Lord. The elevator was out. But walking up steps, you know, after a while you feel good. You're like, ooh, I got a little energy that I didn't have before. God does not want us to go over the steps. Amen? Okay. He said, I know my thoughts, I think towards you, thoughts of peace. Come on. And not of evil, to give you a hope and an expected end, a future and a hope. The Lord told me that after these meetings, he wants to give us the ability to perceive the future. And what I don't mean prediction. I'm not talking about prediction. But we can't say that we're prophetic and we don't have any idea of what God is doing in our lives. So one of the things I want you to put a demand on, don't put a demand on, because this is what happens in meetings. We preach on destiny. You got to be determined. And I said, God is doing a new thing. If you already got in your heart you want to get married, you think I said, ooh, your husband is coming. But that's not necessarily what I'm saying. Come on. This is an hour where God wants us to understand he's taking us step by step. He wants to give us the ability to perceive what he's doing in our lives and prepare for the future. See, we want somebody to say, and June 4th, you're going to meet a man by the side of the road. That's not how the prophetic works. God wants you to begin to prepare. He's going to give you pictures of who you are and what he's designed you to be. He wants us to begin to have a relationship with him. See, we get caught up in the information and not the relationship. He doesn't want you just to say, I got information. You can go to a psychic and they'll tell you right information. But the purpose of prophecy is to lead you to the feet of Jesus, that you begin to talk to him about your destiny. I really believe that God wants us to begin to, I saw in the spirit these doors that were opening, doors. God is opening up doors of opportunity like we've never known it before. But it says, I've opened up a door of opportunity, but there's an adversary there. So just because you got all these open doors, you want to make sure you have the grace to deal with the adversary on the other side. See, you're just not going to step in doors and not have integrity. Come on, you're just not going to step through doors and you mean as a rattlesnake. God is not going to let you go, oh, I have a call to government. Oh, yes, I know I'm called to government. But we can't get you to get a shoe shack. Come on, somebody say the little fox. It's the little foxes that spoil the life. Oh, prophetess, I'm called. I'm going to travel. I'm going to have your mantle. I'm like, okay, when I'm done. Not a minute before. I'm going to nations. Well, beloved, have you just got a passport? See how I came around the corner? Got your pumped up, come on, anesthesia first, come on. No, because remember I said my call is to demystify the prophetic realm. I don't want you next year saying that prophetess said this, but no, prophecy is partial, progressive, and conditional. Partial, progressive, and conditional. We know in part, we prophesy in part. It's progressive and it's conditional. God's, this is what, here is a definition of destiny. The Latin word for destiny is determined. Determined. So there are things that God has determined for your life. He's already predetermined some things. But he's not going to work against your will. If you don't cause your thoughts, your behavior patterns, come on, your relationships, come on, your disciplines to line up with what he has determined, you will never meet your destiny. Ooh. Now, I'm an equipper. We're going to preach and pray and activate and prophesy, but at the end of the day, I want you to be equipped to prosper. Come on. I am tired of just being in a meeting. You done drove how many miles you drove. You can turn on the TV and watch a great preacher, but when we come into gatherings like this, there are certain things. We're all in different levels, but God wants to do the same thing. He wants to activate another level of destiny. He wants to give you one more key that's going to unlock another door for you. I'm telling you, we have to be determined. Whatever God has said, we got to make some change in our lives. Tonight, God is going to circumcise you. He's going to cut away the flesh. Anything that cannot be used, anything that's not going with his destiny in your life, I'm telling you, by the power of God, he's going to cut it. Whatever man that's in your life, come on, whatever project he didn't design for you to do, come on, he's cutting that. He's cutting poverty because we need money to do the things he designed us to do. But the thing he is looking for is diligent. For he said the hand of the diligent shall rule.
God.
And if God said it, that's it. All you need is you and God as the majority. Now, I'm not saying we don't need the church, because I believe everyone, every prophetic believer, every believer should have a home church. You should be somewhere in the church serving your gifts, being molded and transformed, and then being sent out from the local church. I'm tired of these one-night wonders and one-band hustler shows. Come on. They're no different than what the old snake oil meetings they used to have. And you know, three ring circus and some of these things. You pump them up, I'm going to come out and do this. No, 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 no. These are the days when God is equipping his people to be discerning.
Yes.
We have to have discerning of spirits in this hour.
Yes.
Come on here.
Yes.
I know my plans that I have for you, they're good and not evil, to give you a hope and an expected end. And then let's go over here to Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55. We're still talking about destiny. Destiny. It's the thing that only you have been uniquely crafted to do. Come on, Kabaroshi. Isaiah 55 and 10. Well, let's start at 8. He says, for my thoughts, if we go again with those thoughts, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. So what is our goal? We gotta tap into the thoughts of God. That's what the prophetic is here for, is to unlock the thoughts of God. Then he says this, for as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and does not return there, but waters the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. So what is God saying? My thoughts are higher than your thoughts, but this is the time that I'm going to cause it to drop down on you like the rain. I'm telling you, as you're sitting under this anointing, the thoughts of God is flooding your heart, but you got to grab it. And the Lord began to tell me this. He said, the word, this is the problem with many of us that's prophetic. We don't want to study the word. He said, the word is the bridge between my thoughts and your thoughts. If you begin to study this word, God begins to make it like a sword of the spirit. It comes alive. See, you, I can read one scripture and it means one thing to me, and then it could mean, it has a what would you say, a doctrinal meaning, but prophetically it begins to come alive on the inside of you. I'm decreeing that God will begin to speak to you through his word. There are some principalities that will come against your call, but you learn how to take the word of God, which is the sword of the spirit, and you learn how to cut the head of the devil off by the declaration of the word. Come on here. These are days that God has said some things for you. There are some things, there's some paths that he wants you to be on, but the enemy always comes against you with your thoughts and make you think God is not thinking about you. But God said, if you will posture your heart, I'm going to come like the rain. I'm going to come like the rain, and I'm going to give you words and awaken your dreams. Come on here. And they're not going to return to me void. All you need is agreement. See, if I got the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, that's the only agreement I need. Come on, I can pray the word of God and decree what he has said.
Amen.
Could it be the things that we have are a product of what we've been speaking?
Yes.
We've been saying what we have instead of what we want, or what God has said about us. I'm telling you, the Lord says, I'm getting ready to rain on my people. He said, I'm going to cause my thoughts to connect. See, this is the problem. We need the spirit of understanding. There are times where you can even have a glimpse, but you don't really understand it. God told me he was unlocking understanding tonight, where you're going to begin to understand why you are here. You're not going to apologize for what God has designed you to be. And I've never seen so many wimpy, apologetic Christians. I've had people say, shh, don't say that about the homosexuals, you know. I'm like, I'm going to say what I want to say. I'm going to, just like they can say and do, we can say and do. You can't silence me. I have freedom of speech. I am a Bible-believing Christian, and I believe what the Word says.
Come on now.
But if we have all of our insecurities, intimidation, inferiority, we start to move inwardly because we begin to say, I'm an introvert. Now God wants to deal with the things that's happening in us that doesn't line up with what He has said. Come on here. Karobo Shata. Kebro Shemanaya. Psalm 16. I'm moving it. Psalm 16. I'm watching my time too. Psalm 16. God, I thank you. Y'all get anything out of this? Kiarobo Shandalamaya. We're going to spend some time prophesying tonight. But I want you to really put a demand on God that God will unlock your destiny. What are you destined to do? Why did you marry the woman you married? Why did you marry the man that you married? Why are you living in Memphis? What? What is the point of it all? I'm telling you, we're living in a season of convergence. I talk about this in the Esther. He's putting everything together. Everything that makes up you. Why are you short? I used to ask them, why do you make me so short? But when I start prophesying to 6 feet guys and they hit the ground, they know it wasn't me. I say, oh! We're all made. Come on, we're fearfully and wonderfully made. But how many times, thank you, Lord, we are made in the image of God. And how many times does the devil attack us for how we look? I'm not big enough, I'm not fat enough, I'm not skinny enough. Some people don't think they're big enough. I'm not slim enough. I'm not this enough. But you're just what God wants you to be. Oh God. Psalm 16. Oh God, we thank you. 16:11. Can we go there? It says, you will show me the path of life, and in your presence is the fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. There are several things I want to bring out here. You will show me, God, the path of life. I want you to put a demand on the Spirit of God and say, Lord, show me my path. Show me the path for my life. And I believe God is going to begin to restore and redeem. What do you mean, prophetess? Some of us have just made a mistake. We have just messed up. But if we don't ever own up, that I'm on the wrong path and I need to turn around, the wrong path never becomes the right path until you repent and go the other way. I've never seen so many, I'm gonna make this work. And I'm not talking about relationship. I'm not talking about marriage. I'm talking about some things, projects, and things that we put together that God had was not in it at all. But we're just going to keep doing it. We're going to stay with this person because after all, we saved and we are Christian. No. I'm giving you permission to make a definite cut with the past. When God was ready to transition and put Joshua in the place of leadership, He said, look, Moses, my servant, is dead. He said, now you rise up. But He had to tell him, look, the old system is dead. The old way is dead. Yes, he was a powerful man. He was my friend. I talked to him face to face. But that stuff is dead. Now you rise up and walk in your identity. Come on. I don't care what church you came from. God is saying, listen, you are born for this time. You are born for this season. Now rise up. Let go of the things of the past. And, you know, we tend to make monuments to the past. And, you know, oh, I remember when I was a basketball. Oh, baby, you ain't played basketball in a long time. Come on. We keep building monuments. Oh, girl, I remember when I was the beauty queen. See, that's your problem. You keep looking back when God said, forget those things that are behind and reach forward to the things that are what God has designed you to be. But see, we're too comfortable and we tend to demonize difference. We tend to stay around everything that's the same. But I'm telling you, real pioneers are not afraid to be different. Come on. Which person do you think is going to be the one that has the successful business? The one who has 10 Chick-fil-A's or one who comes up with something new? That offers something different. But we're so afraid to be uniquely ourselves that we miss the blessing. One of the scriptures, Apostle Paul said this, I'm not going to go beyond my measure of rule or my metron. Everybody has a measure, a metron. I call it your lane. When you get in your lane, baby, you will reign. When you start doing what God designed you to do, you will begin to move to the top of the food chain. We don't have to be scavengers. Some of us are just scavenger, bottom food eaters. Whatever is at the bottom, I just take that. No, baby. It is time for us. Anything that God has designed us to do, it's going to have greatness on it. But see, then you got to define what is greatness and what is success. It's success. So we think success is everybody, hi, girl, you so fine. Oh, you so powerful. Yeah, no, I don't care. The same people that say, hail her, will nail her, nail her. Isn't that what they did with Jesus? Hail him, Hosanna. Crucify him. People too fickle. No. You gotta define success by my destiny. Am I doing what God has designed me to do? I may not have to see. Some of us are captains over 50. Some are captains over 100. Others are captains over thousands. But if you always trying to be the captain over thousands, and that was not what you were designed to be, you'll die prematurely from a heart attack or a stress or something. No, you want to do what God has designed you to do. You can be just as effective with 100 people as you was with 10,000. Why? Because I'm in my lane. I'm doing what God designed me to be. But we let other people and their success, come on, we're going to stop being the voyeur to other people's life. What does that mean, prophet? I'm always looking. I'm always standing on the outside. I'm looking at her preacher. I'm looking at her write her books. I'm looking at her getting married. I'm looking at her, but never valuing who you are. Never getting in what God designed you to be. Never manifesting what God called you to be. How many people are dying because you will not live delivered? How many people are dying because you won't walk in your destiny? Because you're the one God is sending you to them. Everybody say wonderful place.
Wonderful place.
In Psalms 139, he says, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. What does that mean? I believe in the context of destiny, we all have been fearfully made before the Lord. What I mean is reverential respect. I can't disrespect her, because the reason why we're here is because we have the glory of God on our lives, the assignment. It's nothing but the kingdom that connected us. So I respect her, I honor her. She's fearfully and wonderfully made. But the wonderfully is this, we all have a place where we were designed to be wonderful. We were designed to be wonderful. What does it mean? If you're doing hair, and I mean everybody's lining up, and I come and do hair, but you know, mess some people up, they might leave with plaque patches and plugs. But my sister or my brother is what he was designed to do. He's wonderful in that. Me, I'm called to nations. I'm called to reproduce. Prophetess, how can you travel? I can travel 18 hours. I'm happy. I'm writing. I'm watching TV. It doesn't bother me. And when I get to the nations, they accept me. They love me. They say, good kid.
Amen.
Why? Because they think I'm wonderful. Everybody say wonderful.
Wonderful.
You all have a wonderful place.
Yeah.
A place where you will be wonderful. You'll have fruit. You'll do what you've been designed to do. This thing was not designed by God to be hard.
Thank you, God.
Come on, work. Show me up. That's what some of us doing. All we're doing is working. Come on. Lord. No, 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 no. It ain't supposed to be like that. All we're doing is working hard and getting nowhere. No, no, no. That's not God's assignment for our life. Now listen, I'm not saying everything is easy. But what I'm saying is I have grace to overcome. When I'm in my assignment, I get resistant, I overcome. I get wisdom. See, this is how you know when you're in destiny. Is do you have revelation for what you're doing? Does God talk to you in that place? Do you keep having innovations and discoveries and people are blessed by what you're doing? If not, shut it down. She said, shut it down. Shut it down. We don't remember. I opened up and said, we don't want to have success in the wrong place.
That's right.
Or we don't want to keep religiously. Girl, I'm just going to stay here till things change. Now, why are you in so much pride to think you're the sent one that you're going to change an entire organization? I had a priest, a Catholic priest. Prophetess, I feel like, you know, we tied together and I feel like you're supposed to help me bring change. I said, bring change where? He said, in the Catholic system. I said, the whole Catholic system. He said, yeah, from the Vatican all the way down. I said, oh no, brother, that ain't my assignment. No, some things, what did God do? He waits for some of them down off. Or he what did an exodus, sent people out. How are you gonna go up against the entire Catholic system? I ain't every woman, it ain't all in me. I'm not like Shaka Khan. Come on here. You know, we want to do things in line, in order. We want to see, that's the whole thing. The Bible says you should think more highly of yourself than you are. So you have people where the pendulum swing, where they're so full of pride that they sit to change the whole world. Come on. And then other people feel like the other way is, you know, I can't do nothing, man. Nobody gonna hear me. I ain't nobody. I ain't. No, 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 no. We want to get balanced. God said an unjust balance is an abomination. We want balance in this hour. God wants to balance us out. And look, you don't have to, what is the word? You don't owe anybody any explanations. No, 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 no. You're not gonna kill me. I'm standing my assignment. Somebody said lamentation.
Condemnation.
Now this is what that means. Certain people will have a lamentation, a burden from the Lord to do something. Then they try to take their lamentation and they put it on you. That's your destiny. That's what you lament on. That's what you're going to say. Oh, prophetess, can you come down and really pray for the kids? I really feel like you should be down there with the kids and I want you to teach the kids. And I'm like, well, I'll come down one Sunday. And you go down and you bless them. They said, oh, it's so powerful. I just feel like you need to come down. I said, look.
What you saying?
I'm going to give you some money. You can buy a new curriculum or whatever you want me to call, sow a seed. But this is not my assignment. Well, you don't love the kid. Oh, yes, I do. I did my time with the kids when my kid was a kid. But now she's 27. That's not my assignment. That's your lamentation. Because everybody sees everything through their assignment. Oh, you don't want to go feed the hungry? I will give you some money to feed the hungry, but that's not my assignment. See, when you get locked into what God has designed you to be, you don't let people put their burdens on you. It's nothing wrong with doing you, boo. What do you mean? I got to do what God has assigned me. When I say do me, I don't mean, you know, selfishly. I mean, I have to do my assignment. Everybody has to stay in their lane and where you have the grace. Because I want to stay around for a long time. I don't have to prove anything to anybody. I can't tell you how many. I'm sitting down having dinner with my husband over a beautiful lobster. People, Robert, can I get a word? You got a word for me? No, my word is get out of my face. I'm still getting to living in something. I'm pregnant. What do you mean? I thought you was a prophet. I am a prophet. But my response to your need does not determine whether I'm a prophet or not. How could you say that? What did Jesus say? I am only sent to the lost sheep of Israel. He didn't minister to everybody. What? We can't do it all, beloveds. You have to prioritize. You determine what gets your attention. The Because when people see that you're anointed, and it's really they see the anointing, the glory on your life, they will try to pull you in 10 different directions. Yes. And you waste time doing stuff that's just a commitment. I've been praying, Lord, help me. Because we need to be in the place of our call. I don't want to be somewhere just because I committed.
That's right.
But prophetess, you blessed us last year, and I stopped doing that. I can't wait till you come back next year. Then you commit to come back. Not necessarily fearing the call. And then you get home, you're tired, and go out. You're like, I was like, are you all right now? Oh, I ain't all right. I'm tired. Prophesying to all these people. And it looks like when you start prophesying, they call people on the phone. The more people come in. But you get the gist of what I mean, right? So we want to stay in our lane. All right, we want to stay on the path. He said, I will show you the path of life. In your presence is the fullness of joy. If you do, one of the ways you will know if you are doing what God has assigned you to do is, do you have joy? Do you have, if there's no joy in it, you feel like you're working on the chain gang, you could be a part of slavery. Maybe you acting as a slave and not a son. Some of these churches and some people, they treat us like we on a plantation. The devil is alive. Give us free. Give us free. I got to be for everything and work real. No. No. If you don't have joy. I'm not talking about when a leader asks you to do something and, you know, you committed to. I'm talking about when you feel enslaved and trapped. You can't take a vacation. You can't do it. You can't go to school. And God's telling you, how are you going to go to school? He's going to take you out on Sunday. Well, maybe for, you know, when I'm getting my degree and my assignment, I can't get to church. I might have to look at you on TV. I'm telling you, the thing I have learned, and I made 51 this year, that if you cannot waste your time in the wrong place. You gotta let God hear me and hear me well, young people. You may be gifted and you may be talented, but you gotta get a plan for your life and don't apologize for building your life. You cannot, if God has assigned you to go to schools, I've seen some people locked in these little storefront churches and they won't go to school. Well, my pastor said I can't miss on Sunday. Well, it's not, we don't want to make it a standard to miss, but if I'm trying to get my degree to better myself, I can't be at church on Tuesday. I can't be there on Sunday. And you don't have to feel guilty because a part of your destiny is to get a degree. Of God. He said, in my presence is the fullness of joy. This is what I learned. The Lord will bring the move of God to your house. Did you know you're the temple? Do you know you are the temple? That the presence of the Lord dwells on the inside of you? If there are days when you are doing things He's assigned you to do. Now, I'm not giving anybody permission to be rebellious. I'm not saying don't listen to your leaders and serve your church. Yes, you do those things. But I'm talking about when you have a goal. When God has said, I need you to go back to school, it should not be that the reason why I don't do it because my bishop said I have to be at church on Sunday. The only thing you cannot get back, beloved, is time. So we don't want to waste our time in the wrong place. Yeah, I know. I can feel some of y'all. I thought she was going to really. No. I told you I was an apostolic prophet. We want to lay some foundation. We want to break some mindsets. I'm challenging you. Religious mindsets. And then the other thing is some of us are just lazy.
Come on.
Yes. Amen.
Come on. We don't want to press into the presence. Oh, God. We don't want to press into the presence. We want to press all, you know, instant microwaves. Prophetess, lay your hands on me. Come on, lay hands. Transfer the anointing. Only thing is, I'm still using it. All right. Let me wrap this up because I do want to prophesy. Oh, it's 9 o'clock. All right, let me hurry. Kodabashata. We got room for one more scripture?
Yeah.
Okay, Joel. Did you guys get anything out of this?
Yeah.
Joel. This is what I really heard God saying for this group of people when I walked in. Joel 2, verse 25. And you have to say amen.
Amen.
If you don't, say hold up. Joel 2. I say Joel, some people say Joel. You got it? All right, it says in chapter 2, verse 25, it says, so I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, that the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. My great army will I send among you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God. Hallelujah. Who has dealt how? Wondrously with you. And my people shall never be put to shame. Then you shall know that I am the Lord in the midst of Israel. I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. My people should never be put to shame. I kept hearing the Lord say this for this company of people, that there have been some things that have been chewing on you, eating on you, eating up your harvest. And I kept feeling like some of it is within, lies of the enemy that's chewing up your harvest. God said this is an hour that he's going to begin to break the power of the devil. Whatever's been eating you, he's getting ready to judge. We've got to get ready for the judgment of God. And he said, listen, he said this, I'm going to restore. When God begins to restore, he always does it in a better fashion. He does it better than the original condition. He said, I'm going to restore. I've been praying this, that God will restore the years and redeem the time. Some of us have lost time. Some of us have lost even years. But I'm telling you, after this weekend, I believe the Lord is going to catapult you and accelerate you to a new place of destiny. When you start talking about locusts, in the scriptures, locusts represented judgment. Things that we did in our own mistakes, our own decisions that caused destruction. But I'm telling you, we're in a divine season of mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Amen? Somebody say mercy.
Mercy.
Then he says this. He says, I'm going to deal with shame. I kept hearing that when I walked in the room. Shame. God wants to deal with the shame in our lives. Things that, see, the reason why we have insecurity, some of us, is because we have shame. Shame the way our husbands treat us. Come on. Shame the way we don't have the money that we want. Some people are shame. And God said tonight, he's dealing with the shame. See, shame says you are something wrong. And God is getting ready to break that assignment off of your life. Wherever you've had measures of shame in your life, the Lord is getting ready to bring a tremendous amount of healing. And I kept hearing in the area of finances, a lot of us have been attacked in our finances in the last 3 years. But I believe that God is opening us up. He's really, I can't tell you how I just feel the deluge of the glory of God. And I'm not saying people are going to just put money in your hand, but if you get one idea from the Lord this weekend,
yes.
God can give you one business idea. He can connect you with one person. I believe many of you are one person away from the greatest breakthrough in your life. Come on here. I want you to put a demand on the Lord. See, this is all connected to your destiny. It's all connected to your assignment. When God begins to speak to you, now look, after this, see, God has said, I don't care what nobody says, even God knows it. When your money is funny, you can't hear right. Come on, when stuff is wrong at home, you just doing it by faith. Come on. Yeah, prophet is amen. I know it's right, but something, I can't fully get in it. God knows it too, because this is what he did. Look, he said, I'm going to deal with all your issues. He said, I'm going to restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. There's different levels of locusts. Some that consume you, some things come that just overtake you. There's some things just chew on you, just gnaw, just gnaw, just gnawing at you. Then there's other stuff that's swarming around you. They not at you, but they swarming around you. Come on, we got stuff that's swarming around. Oh, Lord, my house is in foreclosure. I hear that somebody, it ain't close, but Lord, it's swarming. I need to pay my mortgage. Come on, certain things is swarming. Come on, I don't have a husband, but this Jody is all around me. He's swarming, locust. He ain't landed yet, but he's swarming. Some of us hear it and we don't understand understand what that is? Do you have prophetic insight? Come on, them locusts that crawl on you. Come on, certain things just crawling on you. Oh, my Lord. I ain't going to even. I'm telling you, God is dealing with the stuff that's been eating and agitating you. Because, see, it's hard to prophesy. He said, I'm going to do some things for you that you may praise my name. And you're going to be able to say that I've dealt wondrously with you. And then he says, we shall never be put to shame. So there's some things that's happening that you're not going to see anymore. Come on here. I want you all to just, come on, just open up your spirits for a minute. Come on, baby, would you begin to play? And then it says this. Then he says in verse 28, and it shall come to pass afterwards.
Yes. Yes.
What do you mean? See, we say, oh, God is going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh, and the sons and daughters are going to prophesy. Yeah, but there's some stuff we got to deal with first before we get into the prophetic. He said, I'm going to deal with the stuff that's been eating you up and stopping you from your destiny. He said, I'm going to deal with that stuff first and then afterwards. So I believe tonight we're going to deal with the stuff. God, there's an anointing to break stuff. I said God was going to remove barriers to your destiny.
Thank you, God.
He wants to remove those barriers to what's to the next in your life. Then he said, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon my men servants and my maid servants, I will pour out of my spirit, and I will show you wonders in the heavens and in the earth. There's that word wonders again. Wonders is about the state of mind. God is in the business of astonishing us. The word wonders, it talks about bringing your mind into a place of awe. When was the last time you were at awe at the things that God has designed for you? I'm working on my next book, The Ruth Anointing. Ruth said yes to God because destiny was stirring in her. And it caused her to leave everything she knew to a new land. She had no idea that the field she was gleaning in, that she was going to own it, baby. The Moabite. It's just like Sandy kept saying, Ruth the Moabite. You know how we do, the homosexual. Come on, Tommy the homosexual. Because we deify difference. We demonize difference. You know, Sandra with the five kids. I don't care what your makeup, oh, we do blind Bartimaeus. We don't even relate to people by their, who they are. We look at their disability or their dysfunction because they're different than us. We all got stories, we just don't see it in the front.
That's right.
That's right. Yeah, we would go there. I'm going to stay on here because I don't want to turn the place out. Some of us are alcoholics. We could say Tony the alcoholic. Donna, the dirty dancer. Just tell me. You know, but nobody knows that kind of stuff because it's not out. But I'm telling you, if I be a prophet of God, I don't care what situation you came out of, the Lord said he's getting ready to make every crooked place straight, baby. He's getting ready to do some wondrous things in your life, and you're not going to be put to shame. This is the hour if you would just align yourself and really say yes to destiny. God's going to break you out and do some wondrous things. Come on, just because you came from a low place, that doesn't mean that God can't begin to take you to a wonderful place. For I hear the Lord saying, even tonight, I am breaking every stigma, I'm breaking every barrier, and I'm expanding you for more. For I'm creating a capacity on the inside of you, said the Lord, for more. I'm going to pour out more glory, I'm pouring out more favor. He said, these are the days that I strengthen my people with might, and where many of you felt I can't go any further, the Lord says, tonight I shift you into your destiny. Tonight I begin to awaken to destiny, and I'm going to begin to pull you to a new place. from the spirit of lack and hopelessness. For many are dealing with hope deferred that is making the heart sick.
Amen.
But you shall hope again. For every ceiling, I see ceilings over your head. And the Lord says tonight, he's cracking every demonic ceiling, every demonic limitation, things that have been assigned to stunt your growth. The Lord says tonight, I'll break you free. The Lord says tonight, I release new favor, for you shall grow in wisdom and stature and in the favor of the Lord. For there shall come new levels of favor upon many of your lives, and it will not be favor just to heap upon yourselves, but it will be favor for your assignment. It will be favor for your destiny. For even tonight, says the Lord, I give you new connections. For these are the days that I disconnect you. I disconnect you from the past. I disconnect you from every demonic label. I take off every label. For many of you have been labeled. But the Lord says tonight, he snatches all those labels, and you shall be known as sons and daughters of the living God. There shall come new expressions of ministry. Whatever's been locked inside of you, the Lord says tonight, I unlock you. I unlock your destiny. Oh, dream again, for I'm pouring out my spirit, and you shall dream again. For many of you have let go of the dream, but the Lord says these are the days that I call you to stand, and I called you to fight for your dream. Those things that I told you even before you were in your mother's womb, the Lord says new ideas will come alive. For I shall awaken the dreams. For I shall speak to you, many of you, in the night season. I hear him saying, I'm going to speak to many of you in the night season. I'm going to impart. The Lord said, pay attention to your dreams. But just like I gave an impartation to Solomon and gave him the greatest gift of wisdom in his dream, so shall I do with you, said the Lord. And I'll deal with the dream things. I'll deal with the negativity. I'll deal with those that have spoken negative. But there have been many. I saw, it's like a dragon in this region that's spewing out just the negative upon the church. It's like demonic spirits just being released, and it's telling you what you can't do, causing you to measure yourselves among yourselves. The Lord says tonight, I deal with the dragon. I deal with the, it's a spirit of Orion. It's a spirit of pride. It's the spirit of Leviathan. And the Lord says, I am dealing with the spirit of Leviathan, the spirit of hardness of heart, the demon that tries to take away your faith. The demons, it's just like, it's like a heaviness. But many of you have looked at bigger churches and looked at big monuments and said, how can I compare? How can I compete? The Lord says, I'm not designed you to compare and compete. For I've always dealt with the remnant. When I'm ready to release reformation and revival, I raise up a remnant. For I have found a remnant in my people. And I say, look upon the heathen and regard. For I shall work a work in your day that you will not believe, though it be told you. Be utterly astonished astounded. For I'm gonna do some things.
Yes.
I'm gonna do some marvelous things that will cause many to be astounded. So I hear the Lord say, take courage. I don't define you by your mistakes. Take courage.